Welcome to the Well-Read Reading Series, co-sponsored by Works San Jose and Poetry Center San Jose. I'd like to first start off by introducing Joe Miller, president of Works San Jose. How about, Joe, you let us know what's going on over there at Works?
Oh, we just, excuse me, hey, haven't talked in a little while. Yeah, we just closed an exhibition that was our first exhibition that was in person after being closed down for many, many months, as you might think. And it was called Hindsight 2021. It was an all video exhibition with a dozen artists who did projects during the last mostly 2 years, during most of 2020 and then all of 2021, save for this last month. And so some of the series were a couple dozen pieces and some were hundreds and hundreds. And so that was really cool to get back into the sort of public eye there in Works. We did over the summer two exhibitions at Mexican Heritage Plaza, and we have a new partnership with the School of Arts and Culture there, which started with the Mosaic Festival. And so actually saw a few of you guys with the Mosaic Festival, and then we were there for Chile Mole Pozole and there for Viva Calle with artists from across San Jose, but a little bit of a focus on East San Jose over there in the Mayfair neighborhood. So that's a really exciting new new relationship for us that's going to continue into the next year. So we're looking forward to doing a lot more between the two spaces, our space downtown and then this space out at Mexican Heritage Plaza, which is a great gallery out there, activating that space. So our new space, as many of you know, is under construction. It's at the first block of South 2nd Street. That's going to be ready at the beginning of the summer, basically. And so there's going to be new meeting spaces in there where when we can get together in person, we can have like a kind of soundproof room. We could be in the gallery, or we don't have to be in the gallery. If the gallery is like full of sculptures and that sort of thing, we can visit there before and after, and then have a nice nearly 1,000 square foot meeting room and that to have events in. So that's really, really exciting. Check us out on Facebook to see some previews of that, as well as see a little post view of the shows that just happened. We're retooling right now for 2022. So come back, and in January, we'll have a little bit more news about programming that's going on there. So check us out on Facebook. Go to workssj.org, WRKSSJ.org, and see a little bit of recent history. We don't have too much there of what was at MHP, but some pretty cool views of what was just in the gallery closing this last weekend. So we're really excited about the year ahead. We hope, of course, that things calm down as far as COVID is concerned. But we'll be doing sort of mellow events. We got in, as some of you know as well, to doing hybrid events with Flash Fiction Forum, having a very small audience and participants there in the gallery, as well as in our last reading, about 40 people outside of the gallery on Zoom, all simultaneous giant projections up. Go check that out on Facebook. We're just Work San Jose, all one word on Facebook. So go see us there and stay tuned. So thanks a lot. I'm going to give you now, who is right. He's immediately over my head, right there, for me at least. I don't know who's over my head for you, but I'm going to give you the president of Poetry Center San Jose, right there, Rob Pesich.
And the thing went wrong.
Thank you, Joe. yes, my name is Robert Pesich. I'm president of Poetry Center San Jose, and upcoming events over here at Poetry Center: Third Thursday, hosted by Lisa Medley, December 16th, 7 p.m., featuring Nils Peterson, who is in the house. This is co-sponsored by Willow Glen Public Library, and they will be looking at opening up the community room for 2022, probably January or maybe even February for congregate events. So we're looking forward to that. Well Read on Tuesday, January 11th, 7 p.m. will feature Larry Hollist and also Carolyn Grassi and her work to be read by Pushpa McFarlane. We also have Poetry Lounge Saturday, January the 8th. Also the San Jose Poetry Slam on Sunday, the 9th, and Poetry Exchange Sunday, the 21st, and our Youth Poet Laureate kickoff event for the 21-22 season is Saturday, January the 29th. The time and location will be announced soon. So for more information, you can visit pcsj.org. Also visit our Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram page. And subscribe to our YouTube channel for this event being live streamed and also past events. So before we go to the program, I want to acknowledge that the city of San Jose is made up of the lands of the Ohlone people who trace their ancestry through the local mission system. We remember and acknowledge that this land was taken through dishonesty and violence. We remember the connection the Ohlone people have to this region and give thanks for the opportunity to continue to live, work, learn, and pray on their traditional homeland. So let us take a moment now to pay respect to their elders and to all Ohlone people of the past and present. So a moment of silence. Thank you. Now, I'd like to introduce Professor Ken Weisner, who is the editor of the Red Wheelbarrow Literary Magazine. Ken, welcome. And I will give it now to Ken, who will introduce our MCs. Thank you, Ken.
Thanks, Rob. I'm Ken Weisner, editor of Red Wheelbarrow, and just a couple of things. I want to say about, this is kind of the only time that I'll speak to you tonight because we have staff and great MCs tonight, students, ex-students, and screeners and wonderful people who make the magazine happen. Just a couple little things I want to say about this issue and thanking people. It is a little late in the month, a little close to the holidays to do this kind of thing. So I really appreciate that everyone's here. It's just fantastic. I have to thank Rob, Pesich, Poetry Center San Jose for their collaboration on the Poetry Prize that we do and on our launch readings. We work at a community college, and then Rob and the board at Poetry San Jose make that a real community literary life for us. Also, Bill Cazzini and the whole board and Joe Miller of Works San Jose. I'm excited to be able to hold the event in the new space soon. Also, thanks to the poets and artists who enrich us and who are here tonight, each of you. And also the Poetry Prize winners. We have actual winners and finalists and semifinalists here among us who really enriched our lives this year with their poetry. Then there's our staff, many former students and wonderful readers who've been really faithful during the pandemic. Especially our prize screeners. Four of our staff and screeners are doubling as MCs tonight. So that's Cindy White, Julian Parayno-Stoll, Cesar Kent, Stephanie Stein, behind the scenes, Daryl De La Rosa, Grace Lee, Elizabeth Jiménez, Montelongo, who've all done so much for this event to happen. We hope you'll buy our book. I put the, I think I'd like to share the screen just really briefly before we get started. It will show you the website that you can go to download the book. So the book is available in print in January, but it's also available right now. Let me do this correctly. We'll see if this works. Nope, I shared the wrong thing. Haha. Okay, I'm going to share the, I guess I'll share the desktop. And so I want you to see, so at this point, you probably see my messy desktop, right? So now, do you see the website of Red Wheelbarrow? Just give me a thumbs up if you do. Great, there it is. So I'll put the URL in there again for you in the chat, or maybe someone else can do that, but I'll do it in just a moment. But on this Deanza-sponsored website, you can see there's a little place here to click. It will, that little place to click will give you this huge 178-page volume full of poetry and art, interviews, fiction, and you know, you can download it now to your desktop if you have a PDF reader and have the book, although we really want you to buy the book also for so many reasons, not the least of which is that it's really beautiful to hold in your hands and to see all the art. I am going to stop that share, and I'll put those the URL in the chat. If you came late, you should see it up in the chat, but you might have come a bit late and not see it there yet. I'd like to also say that we do this poetry prize once a year. We couldn't have our Red Wheelbarrow either without Deanza College, provides us with office space, and the student body supports a student edition each spring. That's the best student art and writing from Deanza. So we do the national edition every fall like this, but we do a students only book in the spring. Sometimes people are confused because they Google us and they find the student edition, and but we do both. So what about this particular issue? It's really full of great poetry. There is a short story by David Denny, who couldn't read tonight, but who, that's about the challenges of aging. So it's near and dear to many of our hearts here tonight. I would read that for sure. We have wonderful visual art. You've seen the, well, look at the cover artist in just a moment and look at the cover. Exceptional things besides the art and the poetry prize judged this year by Mark Doty. He'll be introduced in a moment. I hope he's here to introduce our prize winners. But he's been a great judge and collaborator this year. And I wanted to say I'm reading his book on Walt Whitman, which if you haven't read it, get it. You know, he has not only biographical and autobiographical information about Whitman in that beautiful book, but also kind of a critical elegance that you don't see in every poet. What else? There are two there. I'm not going to give you all the details, so I don't want to bog us down, but there are wonderful interviews also with Stephen Casisto, David Allen Sullivan, who translates poetry from Uyghurs, from Iraqis, who are both in country and in diaspora. And we have reprinted Gary Snyder, an interview we did with Gary Snyder that students of ours did. But now that we have it in the national edition, it'll be archived for scholars. It's an incredible interview our students did with him, and his wisdom is as fresh as ever. And he's doing really well in his 90s, living in his cabin above Nevada City. Also, the last thing I'll mention is there's a strong undercurrent of a poetry of resistance throughout this magazine. We have, you know, it's really a time when poets are needed and poets are endangered. So we have, you know, we've dedicated our book to the four poets of Myanmar who were killed this past year since the coup. On page 5 of the volume, you see a dedication there. And we have a poet from Myanmar who will read tonight. But in addition to that, we have a teacher from Lebanon where hyperinflation is ruining middle-class lives, and she writes from that despair and poverty. We have Uyghur voices. We have voices from Salinas Valley State Prison. We routinely publish the inmate writing, and Rose Black will share art and poetry from there in a bit. The other forms of resistance in the volume often come from just marginalized voices, professions, and bodies. Anyway, I hope you're as moved by that as I have been, and by all the brave poetry in the world. Thank you for being part of Red Wheelbarrow, and enjoy the evening. So I'm going to introduce now Julian, who will get us going. Thank you.
Hi, thanks, Ken. I'm Julian Parayno-Stoll. I was one of the screeners for this year's Poetry Prize. And this year's remarkable cover, which is about to be displayed on the screen, was created by artist Nye Lyn Tho, who calls herself a commercial and conceptual photographer and retoucher. Images from her manipulated photograph series. Are we getting the image up? Okay, there we go. Images from her manipulated photograph series, Natural Air, selections published here, have won several awards, both in the US and in the UK. Nye consistently aims to uplift those who are often shunned in society. As a Black gay woman, Nye writes that she recognizes the constant need for positive self-reflections, the positive mirrors she's craved since childhood. Since picking up a camera, she has fed that hunger not only for herself, but for people like herself. We have been moved by the art of Nye Lyn Tho and are incredibly proud and grateful to publish it here.
Are you seeing the art?
Hi, I'm Stephanie Stein. I am another of your MCs for the evening, and I was also a screener for this. Next, we have our first poem. And our first poem tonight is from a poet who is also a local hospital nurse. Her name is Joanna Martin. In her poetry, she often reflects on the pain our nurses and doctors have held for all of us these past 18 months as we live with this overwhelming tragedy. Martin speaks her emotional truths. Joanna is working a 12-hour shift tonight, and so she's not here with us live, but she's recorded her poem for us. Joanna is also the author of two books of poetry from Hummingbird Press, The Meaning of Wings and Where Stars Begin. Next, we'll see her poem.
One, it's wonderful to be here at such a lovely occasion. My poem is entitled While on the Ventilator. While on the ventilator, doctors give her a 50-50 chance of living. Give her, and give her four children, a 50-50 chance of losing her, their mother. Her husband explains to their two-year-old, Mommy's sleeping so she can wake up princess. While she's on the ventilator, another patient's brother washes her long black hair, rubs knots out of her curls they jokingly called her bird's nest as children. Ruby-throated beacon of hummingbird, their hope. Our promise, we're going to save you. I die, you die, we all die. As ventilator secrets, you are, we are, made of breath. Robotic devil beast raises helpless chests meticulously, makes love to the still living, miraculous. While on the ventilator, a patient in supine position walks the cut stone mountain ridges. Don't talk to cloud faces. Ground your souls. Hold on with your toes. How did we find ourselves here? Mechanical labyrinth, breakdown of body. Can't speak, can't eat, can't breathe. While she is on the ventilator, her newborn granddaughter takes her first breath, inflates her lungs, begins the count for all breaths to come. Ventilator takes words, whispers a new language. tidal volume, positive and expiratory pressure, fraction of inspired oxygen. Become one with ventilator. Float in and out of consciousness, body elongated, feet miles away, sputum throated into lungs, suctioning core at a great distance, mouth, beak, clavicle wings, tethered flight, crucified down the throat by a plastic tube, mute, taste of oblivion, life and death held in the crystal balls of upturned palms. You have no choice, ventilator whispers. While they are on the ventilator, he loses his job. Her house is repossessed. A new president is elected. Before I die for you, let me just say. Again, ventilator takes words, curse words, how to make love to the earth words, supreme being words. Why don't you be here? See what it's like. See the sum of love. Orbital sockets, nasal septum, malleus, incus, stapes vibrate against forced breath, against masked death. On the ventilator, 2 weeks, 3 months, eternity, who knows? Drugs to lose consciousness, to unremember, paralytic agents, sedation, disorientation, drugs to hold back eternal flight. There's nothing more we can do. Confessional, sinless, it's up to you now. Wordless, she howls the vow, joins the chorus of wavering exhalations, exaltations to God. Thank you.
And thanks, Joanna, for that powerful poem. Next, we have UC Santa Cruz and former De Anza College professor, Marilyn Patton, who will introduce the second poet, who holds up her own troubling mirror of her own time and place, but she is herself a beacon of light. Marilyn will introduce for us Ninyu Ko, also known as Apple.
Thank you, Stephanie. I have the honor of introducing Apple Ko, who was a student in my class at UC Santa Cruz during winter quarter of this year. At that time, Apple, as she had been most of her life, was living in Myanmar and participating on Zoom. As speaking out, as Apple did at that time and does now, is an act of courage because it may have consequences for her and for those close to her. She had included her pseudonym, but tonight she is speaking out under her own name. And fortunately, she is living in San Jose and is relatively safe. It just gives my heart great pleasure to introduce Ninyu Ko Apple.
Thank you. Thank you, Mrs. Patton, for the introduction. And thank you to Professor Weisner for giving me the opportunity to be here today. Good evening, everyone. My name is Ninyu Ko. I also go by Apple. I am from Myanmar, and it is such an honor for me to be able to share my poems with you today, especially because this poem is about a cause that is very important to me and to the people in my country. So to give you a bit of context, I had written this poem back in March in response to the violent takeover of power by the military in my country that took place on February the 1st. And ever since then, more than 11,000 people, including children as young as 5, doctors, journalists, artists, poets, teachers, and students my age have been arbitrarily detained, tortured, and killed by the military. A lot of blood has been shed, numerous families have been separated, and a lot more futures have been destroyed. But the revolutionary spirit of my people still remains stronger than ever. And this poem is a tribute to all the brave people back home who are fighting for our freedom. I hope that after reading this, I will have succeeded in asking you to learn more about my country and to join us in our fight. Here goes. We fight for our martyrs and lion hearts whose blood and bravery paved the way for us, for democracy and a better future for our sons and daughters, and for Emcees, who goes through immeasurable sacrifices for us, only to smile afterwards and say it was her choice to do so. We fight. Our chants and our pain-stricken hearts echo the beating of our pots and pens against the filthy evil they summon with their guns, gases, and cannons, and yet with every breath and ounce of strength in our bare hands, we fight. Until our children no longer have to face the same battles, until our land is restored in all her beauty, pagodas and temples, until we see that justice long overdue is served, and our people, although scarred and battered, emerge more victorious and united than ever, until they realize that they have indeed messed with the wrong generation, we fight. And the next piece I'd like to share with you is a letter I had dedicated to a 19-year-old girl called Jason, also known as Angel. She who was one of the very first civilians to have been killed by the military during peaceful protests. And the news of her death had such a profound impact on me because we were both so similar in our age, in our interest, and in the way we loved our families. And I was hit with a frightening realization that it could have easily been me in her place, and how fragile life can be in the world we live in. Dear Jason, as soon as I heard about you, I looked through your profile. You were beautiful. You liked to dance. You were only 19, bursting with so much potential in life. The relationship you had with your father was rare and beautiful. You were his love, his pride, his world, just as he was yours. I cannot fathom the immense pain and loss he must be feeling right now, but I know this. You were the best of us. You did not deserve to have fallen in the hands of heartless scum like them. They had guns, but you had faith. A strong, resolute, and unshakable faith that can never be killed. Thank you for fighting for us and for setting a shining example of bravery. The impact of how you fought will be felt for generations. Your father is so proud of you. We are all so proud of you. Rest in power, Angel. Thank you.
Thank you, Apple, for writing and sharing this poem. Next, I'll tell us about our next reader, who is DJ Savarese. David James, or DJ Savarese, is an artful activist, public scholar, and practicing optimist. His poems have appeared in the Peabody Award-winning documentary, Deej, Inclusion Shouldn't Be a Lottery, a digital chapbook, A Doorknob for the Eye, from 2017, a multiply authored chapbook, Studies in Brotherly Love, by Prompt Press, and various literary journals. A graduate of Oberlin College from 2017, he lives and teaches poetry writing in Iowa City. Do we have DJ today? Give him a moment.
He should be here. And I believe he's...
Hi, everyone. My name is DJ Savarese. I'm a young man with short hair, glasses, and a goatee. Thank you for coming. We're grateful you're here. I'm reading two poems I wrote as part of a necrastic chapbook based on the artwork of Malcolm Corley. Malcolm and I share the sense that plants shape people, not the other way around. The first poem I'll read is called To Green in Place. The second one is called Redhead.
Speak, I had to use my hands. Help me, I signed to my new father. Help me, and I could tell he wanted to, rubbing my back as I wrenched.
That's me now.
Yeah, I wanted to thank DJ for the poems. There are three of his poems in the magazine, and I was able to screen share them. So when the audio was coming in and out, I hope people saw that. This is a unique and brilliant American poet, and you need to read his poems.
And thank you, DJ. I'm Caesar. I'm another one of your MCs. If you've been to any of our Red Wheelbarrow Poetry Prize things, you've probably seen me because I've been doing this as long as we've been doing this. Our next poet is Deanne's a legend and the host of the monthly First Thursdays reading, both on campus and in Zoom, McTate Stroman II. McTate is a spoken word artist, guest lecturer, and motivational speaker who has shared his work over the past 25 years from such stages as the Comedy Store on Sunset and the New Yorican Poets Cafe in New York City. We love the homage poem he sent us this year. Please welcome McTate Bean Stroman II.
Hello, everyone. I thank you guys for this opportunity. It is always an honor to be to have a poem published in the Red Wheelbarrow. This poem is dedicated to the memory of my aunt, Karen Kitten Dixon, affectionately known as Aunt Kitten. And I wanted to also let you guys know that this poem is also available on iTunes as well. So feel free to download it. It's on also Spotify, whatever platform you choose. I'm in a car right now, so that's the only reason I was not showing my picture, but I'm gonna go ahead and read this poem for you guys. Thank you. It's entitled, It Takes a Village. A true village elder, she offered advice and even shelter. The way she dressed, you saw her. And if you listened, you felt her. Her allure and appeal was dress how you want to feel. She was radiant and bright. From head to toe, more than a glow, she harnessed the light. She spoke so sweet and yet so assertive. She was that place you could lay your burden, just as any Sunday service. Yet, you could call her day or night, a guiding light, full of love and insight, not to mention a wealth of parental advice. Biologically, she did not have any, yet truly a mother to many, a loving daughter, a blessed sister, an amazing aunt, a beautiful and beautifully the quintessential caregiver. Even colleges have realized that curriculums could be devised around her philosophies on how to preserve family ties. Aunt Kitten, there is so much more that I can say, and there is so much more that you shall say through us. I continue to say and stay open. I'm hoping to continue to embrace your loving life. A true village elder, she offered advice and even shelter. The way she dressed, not only did you see her, but you felt her. Thank you very much.
Thank you, McTate, for that wonderful homage. We're moving next to one of our main events for the evening. Although, of course, everyone really tonight is our main event. Most of you know that Red Wheelbarrow sponsors an annual poetry prize in conjunction with Poetry Center San Jose. This year, the contest was judged by the esteemed poet, Mark Doty. Our team of screeners sent Mark 30 poems gleaned down from over 1,700 submissions. And then Mark ranked winners and finalists. All screening and judging was done blind. We are lucky and privileged to have many of our contest winners and some of the finalists and semifinalists here tonight, and to be able to publish their work in Red Wheelbarrow. Our judge, Mark Doty, is of New York City and is the author of 9 books of poetry. Most recently, Deep Lane, Fire to Fire, New and Selected Poems was published in 2008 and won the National Book Award for that year. In 2011, Doty was elected a Chancellor of the Academy of American Poets. Mark has a wonderful new memoir that centers on Doty's poetic relationship with Walt Whitman, entitled What is the Grass, which we all highly recommend. Please welcome our wonderful, generous Poetry Prize judge for 2021, Mark Doty.
Thank you for that welcome. Okay, I have to agree to be spotlit here. Okay. So, 1,700 poems. Imagine you have the task of winnowing 1,700 poems down to 30. That sounds much harder than my task. By the time these terrific screeners got work to me, I had a stack of well-made, urgent, compelling poems, memorable things to read, and I'm faced with a sort of impossible task of deciding what's the best, what's the third best, what's the second best, and so on. All you can do is read with an open mind, be moved, be surprised, be challenged. I was looking for language that stays with me after I finish the poem. I was looking for a sense of the presence of an individual person. When I read a poem, I want to feel I've met someone, met a sensibility, a way of seeing the world. And I'm looking for something intangible, something that just stays with you after the poem is ready. Read this stack of 30 poems. What do you remember? What's the thing that shines in your mind when you've finished? That's a quality of great poetry. There's something about it that gets under the skin, that speaks to the spirit, that engages us in ways we sometimes can't even explain. And that's the mystery of musical language, of rhythm, of all the things that speak to us in words beyond simply, you know, what they mean. So I'm going to introduce the winners in backwards order. So we're going to start with the third prize winner, who I think is going to read for us now. Is that correct? If I understand the schedule here. Okay, so this poem, which is Euphemisms by Karan Kapoor of New Delhi, is a poem that speaks about grief, as indeed many of the submissions did in these days. And the poem is situated within traditional funerary practices, cremation practices in India. And it is particularly a critique of euphemisms, which in fact is the poem's title. It, you know, we use euphemisms to distance us from feeling. We use phrases. A euphemism is a double-edged sword in a way. It's a metaphor. It's a way to touch something we don't want to touch. It protects us, and it perhaps insulates us too. So here is Karan Kapoor with this poem. Welcome and congratulations on the third prize.
Hi, thank you, Mark. Am I audible?
Yes, you are. Cool.
I'm just going to read the poem. It's called Euphemisms, and it has a little epigraph of a phrase that I really like. The phrase in India, in Hindi, is phool chugna. It means to pick flowers as if a bird pecking at a piece of bread. To pick flowers is to pick bones from the embers once the body has been burning for two nights. The men execute alone. Hindus do not want anyone crying beside the dead. Death is a note in the rhythm of life, not the coda. The scriptures think only women cry. I think of my sister who believes death is a translation of matter. She wants to pick her bones from her cremains. The men shove their calloused fingers in the many small and still warm black and white mountains of ash, looking for bones, beaks of crows picking on a carcass. I do not understand why these men are so rough with her. My fingers are moving as if caressing a flame. I pick one small cylindrical flower, dip it in ash, rub it behind both my ears, between my brows, behind elbows and knees, make an impermanent tattoo around my wrist. Afraid my heart stare might tear the flower apart, I close my eyes. I turn around so no one can see me stretch my t-shirt and run a dark line in the middle of my chest. Then I dip my finger in one of the many mountains and thumb the ashen tip on my eyelids, then at last on my navel, waiting for the grains to seep through my skin. Thank you.
Thank you. It's a beautiful poem. And I think, like all the best poems that I know, it has an emotional complexity that was full of grief. And there's also a certain joy, a certain rapture in that contact with the force of life, I think, touching those ashes. Thank you very much. So our second prize winner is a poem called Consider Salt by Judith H. Montgomery of Oregon City. Salt is one of the most ubiquitous of things. It's on every table. It's in practically everything we eat, sometimes too much so. We see it everywhere. How often do we think about it? And this poem is a wonderful consideration of all the ways that salt is part of what surrounds us, is part of ourselves and our own bodies, is something we are very familiar with and don't really understand. And the poem seems to make a vocabulary for salt and build a kind of rhythm and texture of names for this substance. Please welcome Judith Montgomery. Congratulations.
Thank you, Mark Doty, and thank you to the Poetry Center also. This poem is for the poet Andrea Honder, who inspired me to write it. And the title runs into the first line. Consider salts, corralled in the table shaker, or loosed, a star-sprinkled swath across the breakfast egg's gleaming swell, falling unremarked, white grit, on pine planks polished underfoot. Once a salt-stuffed burlap sack could ransom raw silk bolts, count as the Roman soldier's salary. Gibran says, there must be something strangely sacred about salt. It is in our tears and in the sea. Wrapped with fresh baked bread, salt gifts from home to bless new-hewn doors. We praise with salt of the earth, dismiss not worth his salt. But which words would we use for Lot's never named wife? Akhmatova bodies her, looking back toward the burning city to recall the taste of her lost loaves, love's spinning shed, her history, disobedient. Therefore, God evaporates her tears until she's stopped forever. Pilloried, salt becomes her remains, remains of women torn from their towns, their stories, to follow mates or hearts, to desiccate under foreign suns. In our tears and in the sea, each of us salted, the blood that runs the heart is salt as the salt sea that runs and washes every shore, harbors life from pole to pole. Each evaporates to join the air, leaving signs behind as fleur de sel, flower of salt, that rare lace float of white that blooms even as it dries. Thank you.
This is a splendid poem. I hope you hear how rich the sonic texture is, how hard the tongue and lips, teeth have to work to make those sounds in succession, keep a very active kind of quality, and how that poem turns unexpectedly from a hymn in praise of salt to a lament for those women who have been disobedient, who have stood their ground, who have gone out into exile and become themselves in some way. It's a beautiful poem. Congratulations.
Thank you.
And the first prize winner is, and you know, any of these poems could have been the first prize winner, certainly, they're marvelous. This one, there's something about it that stayed with me, and it may have to do with a certain obsession I have with its subject matter. The poem is called, In Respect to the Jellyfish. It's by Susan Cohen of Berkeley, California. The poem has indeed respect for the jellyfish, as it in respect to them. It uses a wonderful cascade of figurative speech to evoke the presence of these slippery, unpredictable, not quite categorizable things. And, you know, jellyfish are too numerous. They are sometimes dangerous. They are occasionally remarkably beautiful. They are sometimes a little bit obscene. In other words, they're rather a lot like human beings in those ways. So we have a wonderful poem that considers them. This is Susan, we got that right, Susan Cohen, and please welcome her for her first place poem.
Thank you. I am so honored and so thrilled to be here, and having heard all the wonderful poetry so far, even more honored and more thrilled to be here. And I look forward to hearing and meeting more wonderful poets tonight. I'm just going to read this poem, And it begins with an epigraph, a line written by the wonderful poet Lucia Perillo. And she wrote, "Because we occupy the wrong animal, don't you too feel it?" In respect to the jellyfish. Even the gelatinous moon jellies, giant jellies, sea gooseberries, and by the wind sailors that litter the beach have lived their animal lives and left a shiny trace that lasts only for a while. Like our own dead, some are still capable of stinging. I step carefully as I look through them, their jellied bodies on the sand melting into gleam, as if they've never known where they end and the world begins. So they dangle in the ocean with a certain uncertainty at the edges, empty in their fullness and filled by their emptiness. Why wouldn't I be content to float day and night, to let my ambivalence take the form of water, shoving me this way and that, to need no protection of bone and leave no fossil, living without architecture outside of history. Thank you.
Beautiful poem, and so much a celebration of the language we might use to try to evoke the jellyfish as other things themselves. Thank you very much. Congratulations.
Thank you.
And there you have it. We're giving away more prizes, but and I want to congratulate everybody who was part of this contest.
All right. Thank you so much, Mark, and the 2021 prize winners. They're just so incredible, such incredible poems. And, you know, by all means, continue to give love in the chat and with the reactions as we continue moving forward. Winners of the Red Wheelbarrow Poetry Prize also receive a letterpress broadside. So Susan Cohen's broadside was created this year by Felicia Rice of Moving Parts Press in Mendocino, with some assistance from Lisa Rappaport of Littoral Press in Richmond, California. Felicia, thank you so much on behalf of all of us. Would you like to say a few words about the broadside as we screen share it?
I'd just like to say what a pleasure it was to work with the jellyfish, thinking mm-hmm. about them on a gray shore on a gray day as I cross their paths on the beach. I could really imagine the space that they occupy and that I occupy here, living right on the sea in Mendocino. So it was a pleasure to work with this poem, Susan. Thank you.
Thank you, Felicia.
It's
beautiful.
This is my first time seeing the broadside, and it's really lovely. So thanks, Felicia. Mm-hmm. And just a bit about Felicia. Felicia Rice is at Moving Parts Press and has printed the moving broadsides for our Red Wheelbarrow Poetry Prize several times now, including this year's, as we've seen. Felicia founded the Moving Parts Press in 1977 to create and publish limited edition artists' books, broadsides, and prints. What you might not know is that Felicia's home and letterpress studio in the Santa Cruz Mountains and 43 years worth of her work went up in smoke in the CZU lightning fires in the Santa Cruz Mountains in 2020. Felicia and her husband Jim are thankfully safe and have relocated to a cabin in Mendocino, but Felicia is now rebuilding her workshop from scratch, including a new studio building. So if you can, please consider donating to rebuild Moving Parts Press through GoFundMe. 10% of the fund will go to victims of the fires in Santa Cruz Mountains. You can order Felicia's broadsides, including some of our past prize winners, at her website. And you can Google Moving Parts Press, GoFundMe, or you can find the URL on page 5 of our Red Wheelbarrow magazine, or we'll also share it right here in the chat, as you can see.
And his college coach was there, Larry Riley, the person who drafted him. So just typical Steph Curry sharing his success with his mentors and his teammates. He had 22 points on offer, Steph and Curry and the Warriors with a big third quarter there.
Hey, Stephen Curry. Thank you so much for the shout out about the fire and the loss and the recovery, the process of recovering over the last year, which has been funded in part by over 750 people and organizations, and a remarkable showing of support for the work I do, and a real reinforced me in my commitment. So thank you again for the introduction and the opportunity to share my story.
All right, my name is Cindy White, and I'm another MC, and also I was a screener, and we would like to wish Felicia and her press all the best, and we hope she flourishes in the year to come. So I am very excited. I get to introduce a few of our finalists, and some of my favorites are among them. Janine Cherto is the author of Elixir, winner of the New American Poetry Prize and the Laurea Frasca Poetry Prize from New American Press and Bodegata Press, 2021, as well as Nimrod's Pablo Neruda Prize for Poetry. She is an associate professor at Michigan State University. You can visit her at JanineCertoPoet.com. Welcome, Janine.
Thank you so much, Cynthia. Thank you to the Poetry Center and to Ken, all the MCs, and Mark Doty. It's an honor to be in this issue and to be at this event. The language of dogs. Lab mix, found without tags. Same black coat, same weight, same name as my dead dog of 2 days. I paced outside the cages. An 11-year-old beagle shot me a look of disappointment, then turned her back to me. The vet said they do that sometimes, become grief-stricken of never being chosen. The dog I came for had visible ribs, a patchy fur, loss from stress. The volunteer escorted me to a private room. I already knew I was good at this, armed with training treats for when he sat, shook. I took him for a test walk. He pulled, zigzagged the trees, our route circuitous. I drove off with Harley, a temporary leash, and a bag of dog food. He slept in the relief of the back seat in the balm of my satisfaction. It was strangely like driving a loved one home from the hospital, held on all sides by blue and the branch silences and hesitation of Thelonious Monk. Home, he played limply with a toy, fed from the old dog's bowl, slept in the new bed. But when he woke, he leaped on the couch, and upon catching his reflection in a mirror, broke a lamp. Stunned, confused, he barked without stop, watched and waited for what I would do, what he would do. There in the clash of sporadic sun and oak, he towered, back legs rooted, almost eye level with me, chest forward as if on display. A face of love howling, a face so right to be asking, now what?
Thank you so much. I love that poem so much. I loved it when I first saw it, and I mean, it's just incredible. The next one too, I also loved, so thank you for the reading, Janine. I'm sorry. Okay, so Stephanie Harper is a recently transplanted Oregonian living in Indianapolis, Indiana. Harper is the author of the chapbooks, This Being Done and The Death's Head Testament. Welcome, Stephanie Harper.
Hi, oh, it's great to be here. Yeah, I'm actually kind of awe/starstruck and ever so honored that my poem was chosen as a finalist, and I'm excited to share it. It's just kind of a little thing that the more I think about it, the more humongous it gets. It's about a bird. It's called Cassowary. 6 foot tall, double wattled southern fowl, flightless, aficionado of fallen laurel, plum, wild grape, nightshade, and strange, neither to fungi, grasses, frogs, snails, nor carrion. Mohawked with a battering ram, pate of peacock and cobalt blues, perched atop a stately stretch of scarlet neck. Defender of emerald eggs in clutches of 3 to 8, swift with a fatal rib kick or phalangeal dagger strike to slice a jugular. What pools so dark in the bushnut brown heart of your gaze? A matter profound or merely far away? Thanks, everyone.
Thank you, Stephanie. Our next reader is finalist KT Landon, who is the author of the chapbook Orange Dreaming. KT's work has appeared or is forthcoming in Spillway, North American Review, Narrative Presence, and Best New Poets 2017. Welcome, KT Landon.
Thank you so much, and thank you to everyone who's worked so hard to make this amazing night of poetry. It's really wonderful. My poem is a response to the book of Job, where Satan persuades God to test Job's faith by taking away everything, starting with killing his family. It's called Restoration, and it starts with an epigraph. Also, the Lord gave Job twice as much as he had had before. It's Job 42:10. What the whirlwind takes up comes down again, but never in the same place and never the same. God, as your worst ex-boyfriend, the one who smashed your dead mother's china, bought you something better, and says your lack of gratitude is your lack of faith. What kind of love bleeds around the edges of power? Job, full of years, at dinner with his new wife, new sons. The desert night, a canopy of stars above them. The air is soft, there is wine and good food, and the laughter of his family swirls around him. He offers a careful prayer of thanks to God for all his blessings. No reply. Behind him in the restless sand, 10 graves tended. Thanks.
Thank you, KT. And I just want to say that usually I think Ken puts us up to present people that we, or poems we really enjoyed. And it's funny because Cynthia and I have been doing this for years, and we're often find each other on the opposite side of a poem. And you can kind of see sort of maybe here our sort of favorites and the type of poems that we enjoy. So that's just an enjoyable part of the process, is that I enjoy being on the opposite side of the poem with Cynthia very often. So up next, we have Preeti Vingani, who is the author of Mother Tongue Apologize, winner of the RL India Poetry Prize. Her work has been published in many journals, including the Three Penny Review, Gulf Coast, and Cortland Review. A graduate of University of San Francisco's MFA program, Preeti has received fellowships and support from UCross, Napa Valley Writers Conference, PEN America, and the California Center for Cultural Innovation. Welcome, Preeti Vingani.
Thank you so much. And I want to send out massive gratitude to all of the readers who had to go through 1700 applications. Thank you for reading all our poems, and to Mark Doty for being so generous with your words, your thoughts. I've enjoyed this so much. It was my first time submitting to the Red Wheelbarrow, and I am so overjoyed that I get to share space with all of y'all. Here goes my poem. What this elegy wants is to never be caught alone at an Italian bakery, buying a dozen cream horns, confessing to the uninterested cashier, "These are my mother's favorite." Are, not were. Not the quiver in the finger over the cursor contributing to a cancer research fund. How much giving is good enough for grief to give up? How much research? I have seen my father research a new bride, second chance and cleanstart.com and well-meaning aunts. I have seen my mother's white nightie hang behind the bathroom door like a god's robe and compared the divine Rogan Josh my new mother makes to my mother's and her roti's lacking fluff, her high salt sabzi, the littlest flaw in her chutney. Her every endearment, a splinter in my ears. Grief, you grumpy mother-in-law. This elegy is tired of you, as in housewife tired, as in housewife staying quiet about abusive husband tired, as in if my mother were to see me, which I'm certain she can, rummaging through the squalor of grief, through a portal where cream horns are limitless and free, she'd continue to snack unbothered, flakes of pastry sprouting on her lip, and she'd say, exhausted yet excited as she would so often get when chasing down a cockroach, scurrying around the house with a long broom. She trapped the apocalypse surviving beast in the broom's hairs, then smacked the jhadu over and over against the floor and draw out the wiggling enemy by its one antenna, fling it straight outside the window. And as if that freeness was hers too, shout, go be free. Into the certitude of gravity. Thank you so much for listening to me and having me here.
Wonderful, Preeti. Wow, y'all, this is a good evening. Thank you for that great reading. We're going to feature some of our East Coasters now, or I should say one of our East Coasters, unless Andrew Gent is in the chat, is in the call. And then we're going to offer you another art interlude. We'll hear in this segment from upstate New York, Iowa City, and New Hampshire, land of great snowdrifts, nightcaps, and blazing hearths. Welcome, Ralph James Savarese. Ralph James Savarese is the author of 2 books of prose and 3 books of poetry, including the recent Someone Falls Overboard, Talking Through Poems, a collaboration with Stephen Cusisto. He lives in Iowa City, Iowa. He has been so prolific during the pandemic, it could flabbergast you. Welcome, Ralph.
Thank you. I did not write that introduction, just so you know. Really great to be here. Fabulous poetry I'm hearing. Thanks to Ken and everybody else. I'm going to read one poem about my son, who's autistic, who read earlier. We're having a kind of ongoing medical crisis with someone in our family, may or may not have Huntington's disease. And I don't know whether you know anything about that, but it's pretty grave prognosis. So this poem's called Clown Palace, and it begins with an epigraph from George Huntington from unpublished notes for a 1909 lecture at the New York Neurological Society. Quote, driving with my father through a wooded road leading from East Hampton to Amagansett, we suddenly came upon 2 women, mother and daughter, both tall, thin, almost cadaverous, both bowing, twisting, grimacing. 1. Like cattle at a salt lick, we couldn't resist the taste of early death. We were at a McDonald's where we used to live, waiting to order some fries when a woman, let's call her an incomplete stranger, after all, she lacked courtesy, came up to me and pointing like Edward Scissorhands at my boy, her nails were that long, said, it's such a shame. He's so good looking. It was lunch hour and the place was packed like birds in a can, everything chirping, everything twitching, metallic thrum had not so much landed in our ears as begun to move around in them frantically. Because my son's perceptual life requires assembly. Think of it as a piece of furniture you buy online. You better have a screwdriver and a set of pliers. He needs defenses. A bottom-up processor, he trusts his senses, not ideas. He inspects everything. His mind is like a coastal town without a levee. The world floods in. And so he flaps his arms to counter it, to self-regulate. little clown palace turned shattered aviary. I went pomegranate. I went strawberry. I went grape. It's such a shame you're so ignorant, I shouted at the woman. It's such a shame you're so old and so wrinkled. Yuck. The manager phoned the police, who then asked us to leave. One of the officers said she didn't call him retarded. That, friends, is the limit of sensitivity training. Cops have shot Black people and autistic people for less. Get out of here alive, I told myself. 2. More than a decade later, I happen upon Huntington's report of his first encounter with those who'd soon have his name stapled to them. I stared in wonderment, he wrote, almost in fear. What could it mean? The primal scene of stigma, a child leading with his frontal lobes. The eyes in service are cattlemen branding steers. Up on their high horses, they prepare meat for market. It doesn't mean anything, George. Thanks.
Thank you, Ralph, for that poem. Next, we have a resident of Seattle, formerly the inaugural poet laureate of Santa Clara County. Nils Peterson is a professor emeritus of English and Humanities at San Jose State University, where he taught pretty much everyone he met to love books and music too. Nils has published science fiction, several chapbooks, a memoir, and 3 collections of poetry. The last, All the Marvelous Stuff, was chosen as the best poetry book of the 2020 San Francisco Book Festival. Welcome, Nils Peterson. Do we have Nils? Just a minute, let's see. Okay, so maybe we'll skip Nils for just now, and then if he comes in, we can go back to him later. Next, we're going to see some art from Santa Cruz and Barbara Lawrence, who slows down to gaze on the cliffs and groves, sloughs and wetlands of the California coast, which she has done for 80 years. Barbara was born in San Francisco and has spent most of her life in the Bay Area. She taught life drawing and advanced painting at the Pacific Art League in Palo Alto, and is currently painting full-time in her Santa Cruz studio. Barbara was recently the featured artist in the 2015 and 2017 landscape issues of the online Artist Portfolio magazine. Beautiful art from Barbara Lawrence. And I think next we have Julian, who's going to introduce another poet.
While Julian's getting there, I just would want to say that you might have noticed. Oh, Julian, are you there? This is Ken.
Yes,
while you're preparing to it always throws us a little off if someone disappears, but we're right back on here. So I just wanted to share this image that I passed through with Barbara's slew of color painting on it. She does these amazing paintings of a kind of autumnal wetlands. It really reminds me of the core of where we live here in the Central California. And I just wanted to mention that it's on that page 5 where we have honored the poets of Myanmar who passed away. Maybe it was just as well that you saw it in silence. I'm sure you read the words. And then at the bottom is a way to support Penn International, which is, you know, the older I get as a poet, the more I want to support Penn International, who is looking for political prisoner poets, who is out to help poets all over the world who are struggling with authoritarian regimes and censorship. So that's it. I'll stop the share now. And Julian, you're on.
Okay. So, well, thank you, Barbara Lawrence. Our Poetry Prize semifinalists, Milica Mijatovic, a Serbian poet and translator. Born in Brčko, Bosnia and Herzegovina, she relocated to the United States, where she earned a BA in creative writing and English literature from Capital University. She recently received her MFA in creative writing from Boston University and is a recipient of a Robert Pinsky Global Fellowship in Poetry. Welcome, Milica.
Thank you so much. That was lovely. Can you hear me? Yes? Okay, awesome. I'm so happy to be here. Such lovely poets, and I feel like even lovelier people. I will be reading one of my poems called Novo Brčko. It is for my grandma, who lives in the sweetest, most wonderful apartment in Brčko. And when I think of home, this is what I think of. Okay. Novo Brčko. Baka's one-bedroom apartment is a blue dusk-colored poem. Its pigeons coo me awake. City buses cradle me in their wheels. The balconies, one in the bedroom, the other in the living room, let just enough of the outside world in. Soft shadows on the wall play hide-and-seek with my dreams. I sleep on the pull-out couch, brush my teeth in the purple-tiled bathroom, eat on the wooden chairs Veda bought a few centuries back. It's just my grandma and me. We look through black and white photographs of her life. I watch as she lingers over some, passes quickly over others. She brings out mama's wedding dress and I put it on, twirl. She cries. I sink into my book on the couch as the TV hums just one octave above the refrigerator. It's blue dusk. The sun is setting. The curtains walk with the wind, and I remember Deda's impressive collection of pins. We run out of drinking water, so I head down to the public fountain, two empty jugs in my hand. I read the graffitied signs again, mostly love declarations and nationalistic leanings. I climb the two flights back home. Baka serves peaches and plums, and we talk about the weather. There's enough hot water to shower, and I listen to the 11 p.m. bus from Beograd zoom into the station. Baka plays a movie. Tonight, it's Ocean's 11. We doze through the action, murmur goodnight. I head to my room, embrace the cool sheets as the old, drunk men in the bar across the street sing some obscure battle song, strum their guitars off key, and I let them lull me to sleep. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Milica. Talking about poems that we loved on first reading, that was one of those for me, absolutely. Next, Mackenzie Cole lives in Missoula, Montana, and has an MFA from the University of Montana. Recent work has appeared in Willow Springs, Whiskey Island, Pacifica Literary Review, Ghost Town, the Sonora Review, and elsewhere. Welcome, Mackenzie.
Hi, thank you. I really am grateful to get to read all these wonderful poets and be included. I'll get right to it. I'm haunted by where our hands would. I'm haunted by where our hands would have touched one another, where our hands gesture, reach out, take one another like ghosts as we sit still and quiet, holding on like stars. So we hold on across one vast distance burning. She was thinking of signs for a plant garden when her boss told her to use had, to use used, is to be less confusing because we may never know the Salish are still using yarrow the same way they once used yarrow. If they are, if they had, if they will again. This way, no one coming into the garden, my friend M told me yesterday, would have been, be confused by the unusual grammar, the make-believe in a garden of make-believe. The Salish names for plants beside the English without a word about the genocide before this garden, a genocide seeded and hidden by the English language. We could have all stood, all stand, to be more confused about our he or she, our they, to be less firmly planted in our mouths. Could all stand to ricochet more meaning, to look a long time into the muteness of each other, to fall heavy from the sky and thick, to settle over patches of mud and grass until the land is white and then to melt away in the rain, to be less firm in ourselves, myself, oneself, themselves, and I, to be held across vast distances and still be left aloft, floating, burning. Thank you.
Thank you, Mackenzie, and say hello to your dog for me. Our next semifinalist, Kim Nall, is a poet and educator from Dallas, currently pursuing an MFA through Carlo University's Low Residency Program in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, and Dublin, Ireland. And she's a talented musician. Welcome, Kim.
Thank you. I'm honored to be here. This February of this year, there were winter storms in Dallas, where I live, that were of a caliber that it would be an understatement to say we were not prepared for. Among our lack of preparation was the almost complete failure of the Texas power grid temporarily, during which many residents of Dallas found themselves without not only power, but without water. And that, complicated by the pandemic, made visible, I think, a lot of the fault lines in both the design of our city and the cultural climate of it. And it also, I think, revealed the importance of just the basic resources that we take for granted. And so I wrote this poem in response to that time. It's called "Now We Know What We Mean When We Say Water Is Holy." Now we know what we mean when we say water is holy, holy like the river they dammed to build this city, the alchemy of water for oil, bricks for barons, and mudflats for everyone else. Holy like the floods that shake the south, where the word is water, that shake our faith and turn saints to refugees lining up in the Superdome to receive the sacrament of a boxed meal and 2 9-ounce bottles while the storm rages in the streets. Holy like the thaw, like black ice, slush, the drama of folly and escape. Holy like the communion of a gushing fire hydrant, neighbors filling pots, buckets, desert mouths, a river swirling luxuriously at our feet and flowing, glittering into the gutters. Holy like that, like shall we gather at the river that flows from the alley behind Neiman Marcus. Last night, I swear I saw them bring out the cisterns from the Cathedral Guadalupe and pour holy water into Dixie cups for anyone who wanted to drink. Thank you.
Well, let me recover for a second. That was an amazing reading, and the poem is also amazing. One of the things that I love about this, I love it more in person, but it's okay on Zoom, is that we read all these poems and then we get to hear people speak them, and it's just so different hearing them spoken. So let me get myself back together. Our next poet is Rose Black. See if I can find information on her. I know I have it. Sorry, I just got all sort of turned around. So now I have to find Rose. There it is. All right, Rose lives and works at Renaissance Stone, a sculpting studio in East Oakland. Her poetry has been widely published, and she is the author of 3 books, Clearing, Winter Light, and Greenfield. Rose teaches poetry at Salinas Valley State Prison and is one of the founders of Right to Write Press, a nonprofit that promotes the growth of emerging writers who are incarcerated in California state prisons. Let's welcome Rose.
Thank you. Thank you so much. I'm really enjoying this very much. I teach at Salinas Valley State Prison along with Ken, and that prison is 5 miles north of the city of Soledad in Monterey County, California. Our DYARD poetry workshop program was started there in 2012 by prison psychologist Benjamin Block and the poet Ellen Bass. But the DYARD workshop has recently been moved to AYARD because there's just more inmate and staff leadership there. And since our teaching team has still not, is still not teaching again in person, we supply workshop prompts and lessons to a recreational therapist and inmate facilitators. This year, the Red Wheelbarrow is privileged to publish the work of 4 inmates, including a special feature on the unique art, poetry, and journaling of inmate Jessica Diana Garza. The current workshop instructors are Lisa Sharnock, Julie Murphy, Ken Weiser, and myself. And we helped initiate Right to Write Press, which you've just heard, promotes the growth of emerging writers incarcerated in California state prisons. We publish inmate chapbooks and broadsides, and we continue to mentor our students even after they've been transferred to other yards or other prisons. This has been especially helpful during the past 2 years of COVID, which often meant for the incarcerated being locked in their cells for up to 23 hours a day. So one of the former DYARD workshop students with whom I correspond is Ubaldo Teque Jr. And he's originally from Guatemala via Southern California. His poetry and prose have appeared in Red Wheelbarrow, Pilgrimage, and Erotic Review, and were read on Central Coast poetry shows on Santa Cruz Community TV. His first collection of poems and essays, Niño Inmigrante, was published in October 2020 by Right to Write Press. Mr. Teque also writes essays and memoir, and he enjoys translation and has translated many of his father's poems. This year, we're publishing 4 of Mr. Teque's poems, which he was able to write in spite of having a serious case of long COVID. The poem I've selected to read to you now is called Central American Dream. Central American Dream. I reach the yard's fountain as my brothers and sisters reach the border. A dream served cold, stumbling into a nightmare. The cornfields are dry, like my dark, salty skin. The forests invaded by drought, the clouds are empty. Mother Earth is having a miscarriage, she's spinning wobbly. My step is fragile and slow with nowhere to go. The smell of order, metal and concrete soldered together, promised to hold me for the rest of my life. Writing my fury and sorrow, I remind everyone that I'm still alive. Startled by the prison's alarm, I sit up. When a fog of pepper spray creeps towards me, I pull my t-shirt over my face mask and shut my eyes tight. Another disagreement, another fight. An icy fire burns my skin, a mean cough moves my neck. The virus, which one, hate or COVID? And now I'd like to talk about Jessica Diana Garza, who is currently in the A Yard workshop. And we are going to screen share and show some drawings of hers. Oh, now, okay, I didn't expect this one quite yet, but she was published in the 2016 Red Wheelbarrow called The Writer's Life. And this issue was banned for distribution in prisons by CDCR. And they were citing this cover artwork called Birdbath as the reason. They said it was obscene because it showed frontal nudity. But this magazine is available at the Right to Write Press website. So we're hoping that this time, 5 years later, the Red Wheelbarrow that again honors Miss Garza will make it to her cell uncensored. Okay. Okay, so now we are seeing the artwork that was published in the Red Wheelbarrow and some of her writing that goes with each pen and ink drawing. Her subject material ranges from boxing to soup kitchens, from crickets to cats, from drugs to the transgender experience. And this one right here is dumpster diving. She ran away from home when she was a young teenager, and I asked her how she survived, and this is one of the ways she was able to eat. Okay, here we have soup kitchen and hobo stew. And this is Prison Cat, and she writes about an imaginary cat, which she believes every prisoner deserves to have. Animals are very important to her. Here's a boxing match. Ms. Garza was at one time a professional boxer. And this pen and ink drawing is called Shoulder and Time. And it may be the cover image of the chapbook that I'm putting together for her. And here's her Folger's Coffee drawing, which she loves. And this is another, stop right there. I've chosen to read this poem, which goes with the image on the left, called War Came Calling. War came calling when I was a child. What could a child know of war? Smell of beer, drunken, angry words, ready to blow up, kaboom. Smell of sweat and blood, of fear. Red welts, blue black bruises, a fat lip. We children looked upward for help, saw a sky startled by the fight. Who, we asked, intervenes in wars? A time when war came overseas to rice fields and jungles. It colored red the army of green locusts where the helicopters landed. Their swirling blades mimicked the jungle's rapidly firing bullets. Pow, pow, rat-a-tat-tat. Soldiers mowed down never came home. A favorite uncle called to war in Vietnam. While father's voices thundered at home, shaken, awakened children ran and hid in closets, crawled under beds. The child I was so long ago lay in the dark trembling when war came calling. Mirror reflection, prison bars on darkly shaded glasses hide my pin-pupiled eyes that grew up too fast where war came calling. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you, Rose, for your great work bringing us writing and art from inside Salinas Valley State Prison. our next reader, Susan Florence's career has been writing and illustrating gift products in 30 gift books for many years. But it is the creative process of poetry that keeps her profoundly connected to herself, finding ground, especially during these uncertain and difficult times.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
Thank you. Portrait of an undocumented, now essential worker. Salinas Valley, California, April 2020. Rosa stoops low with the sun, sets the short-handled hoe down, shifts from beds of broccoli rows to the rattletrap company bus on the side of the field road. Wrapping a white bandana, she masks her face, pulls on two pair of gloves, latex, then cloth, keeps her space in the line that forms. Catching coronavirus is not her only concern. Now empty store shelves stand clean of staples, picked like fields, culled of crops, basics for burritos that sustain Rosa and her daughter Luz, keep them to routine, good health through harvest and days hunched over. 10 hours of dust as wet marine layers lift into sun, shoulder to shoulder, then the bus to barracks on the 101 in Salinas, the salad bowl of the world. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you, Susan. Our next reader, Sam Ambler's writing has been published in Christopher Street, the James White Review, City Lights Review number 2, and Visitant, among others. He won the San Francisco Bay Guardian's 6th annual poetry contest. He has worked in a nonprofit theater at Berkeley Rep, Geffen Playhouse, Actors Equity, and the Wallace Annenberg Center for the Performing Arts. Please welcome Sam Ambler.
Oh, you're muted, Sam.
Okay, can you hear me now? As the torment of a scorpion. My first encounter with a scorpion, I was a teenager in a barn on a kibbutz in Israel. I was in process of picking up a loose bale of hay when I was stung for my audacity. I reached recklessly into its realm and grabbed hold. What did I expect? I can't remember what happened to that scorpion. I hope I stomped the life out of it. I felt its poison immediately. The pain, the swelling, the numbness, the sting that sinks deeper than any flesh wound. It is this feeling, this pain, this fear of unknowing, this agony that comes back when he is dead by his own hand without telling me why, without my sensing its imminence, the pain, the numbness, the sting. He breaks my heart by stilling his own in silence. Thanks.
Thank you, Sam. That was really moving. All right. It's my pleasure to introduce Santa Cruz Poet Laureate David Allen Sullivan. David's books include Strong-Armed Angels, Every Seed of the Pomegranate, a book of co-translation with Abbas Kadim from the Arabic of Iraqi Adnan El-Sayeh, Bombs Have Not Yet Breakfasted Yet, and Black Ice. Most recently, he won the Mary Ballard Chapbook Poetry Prize for Take Wing, and published Black Butterflies Over Baghdad with WordWorks Books. He teaches at Cabrillo College where he edits the Porter Gulch Review with his students. Welcome, David.
Thank you, and thank you for the amazing evening of poetry and the incredible breadth and talents. Really marvelous to hear. I'm going to read two short co-translations and then a poem of my own from the recent book. The first, and Ken and I went back and forth on whether to publish these Uyghur poets. We decided to just write anonymous Uyghur poet because the long arm of China is a very dangerous thing. So this is a poem from a Uyghur poet I met when I spent a year in China teaching in Xi'an 8 years ago. And it's called The Secret. The wind reads my secret, but won't whisper it to anyone just yet. If you try to know my secret too eagerly, you'll miss out on helping puff up the dandelions with me. Can you smell it drift from a wildflower? Though you may ask for it over and over, you won't get near it without a drop of water from summer. And a short poem by a Chinese poet. Is an urban poet. Her name is Li Tu, and it's a little feminist dig called Life. I scrubbed the pot lid twice, inside, outside. Scoured the pot twice, wiped down the stove twice, top, bottom, bottom, top, rinsed the rag over and over, then washed the cherries and brought them to the one sunk into the sofa with his feet on the tea table.
Nice.
And the last poem, the recent book, I'll be reading from it. First in-person reading, all goes well, fingers crossed, at Bookshop Santa Cruz, January 19th. The book is called Black Butterflies Over Baghdad. The artwork on the cover is by an Iraqi who has immigrated to LA, and that is Ghassan Gaid. This is the last poem in the book. It's called Interrogation. It's in two voices. One's an interrogator and one is an Iraqi artist. Why have you hidden the man's face? The paintings of the horse, not the man. Well, why is his cuff frayed? Does he represent the poor? He's a farmer. He is poor. Why did you paint the horse with nostrils flared? Horses widen their nostrils when smelling. Why are its teeth bared? It's lipping up the fig from the man's hand. Why does the horse's cheek strain? Its muscles are working, extending around the brown fist of the fig. You've shown the ribs of its chest. Yes, the horse has ribs. Its eye seems crazed. Crazed is in the eye of the beholder. But it looks out of the canvas at us. While I painted, the horse noticed. Then you admit it's about duplicity. It's about a horse, a fig, a man. You've left out the artist. I try not to be in my work. So you admit you're in hiding. I admit it's a painting. Do not leave the country in case you're wanted for further inquiry. Then do not take the country from me. What was that? Or the horse or the man? Do you want to go hungry? I want to grow kinder.
Thanks, David. That's so wonderful. It's especially great to hear poets from other parts of the world. So we appreciate you doing that. All right. San Jose poet and artist Elizabeth Jiménez Montelongo has exhibited her visual artwork across the United States, and her poetry is published widely. Elizabeth is a member of the board of directors of Poetry Center San Jose, manager of Roots Artists Registry, and editor of the magazine La Raíz, pardon my pronunciation, among many other things. Please welcome and thanks, Elizabeth, for sharing your art and poetry with us. Nice to see you.
Hi, nice to see you. Thank you, Cynthia. And thank you, Ken, and Red Wheelbarrow Magazine for having me. I'm going to read my poem. Her name is Freedom, and this poem was inspired by my daughter and just memories of myself as a little girl. Freedom is a little girl. She dreams up the impossible just to make it possible. She invents a rule just so she can break it. When they tell her she can't, she does it three times, and three times as fast, and three times as well. She doesn't want to be controlled. I want to do what I want to do. She makes what she's missing. She finds another way. She stands by her opinion until perhaps convinced otherwise. No shame. She is who she is. No regrets. She did what she did. Yet sometimes she is sorry, and she's not afraid to change. She laughs after hours. Her outside voice is her only voice, and it must be heard. She has ideas, and she gives them life. She has dreams, and she makes them reality. And I am here, holding her hand, telling her que sí se puede, even though she already knows. She is an artist. She is a storyteller. She is a creator, as fierce as she is sweet. Freedom is a little girl. Thank you. And I think Ken is going to share some of my artwork, and I'm just going to read a statement that goes with it. So there it is, artist statement by Elizabeth Jiménez Montelongo. In the series, The Euphoric Dance of the Unconquered Mind, textured oil paintings of Mexica, Aztec dancers, exude energy and power to celebrate the continued tradition of indigenous dance ceremony. This work is based on Mexica dancers from the San Francisco Bay Area who preserve and practice indigenous Mexican dance in the 21st century across social and political borders. To create the work, I crop and combine my own photographs of dancers in movement and apply paint with a palette knife to create heavy impasto. These paintings honor our indigenous ancestors and local culture keepers and celebrate liberation of the mind. Thank you.
Wow, Elizabeth, wonderful, vibrant art and excellent poetry. I think I may have even seen some of your art in the Mountain View Center for Performing Arts. And now we have our next reader, Hikari Leilani Maya. Is a Japanese-Filipina American and an MFA candidate at the University of San Francisco who identifies with the LGBTQ community. She has publications forthcoming in Cobra Milk and The Bitch and Kitsch, MacGuffin, and many other journals. She currently lives with two snakes and a disabled cat, but has a menagerie of other pets at home in the Central Valley. She's a behavioral therapist for children with autism, pianist, percussionist, music arranger, and a competitive card player. Welcome, Hikari.
Hi, do you guys hear me?
Yes.
Yeah, lit. Thank you for to all the staff here, and it's, wow, my face is really big. Okay, and to everyone who has helped put this magazine together. So it's been an honor being in this magazine and hearing all these lovely poets tonight. So I just have one poem, it's called Jazz. I snip the E off of emotion with a snap of my fingers. Ha ha, move, bitch. Shake those pear hips to the sound of rain dancing through cement firmament. I know I haven't written in a while, but I still slant my A's and my T's even when I'm not paying attention to my Q's because they just too damn loud. Here. I'll send you a postcard from the Fillmore District of San Francisco telling you how much I miss the swoop of trumpets, the golden swoon of trombones, and the velvet tones of a bass so deep, sharks deep in the bay bob their blunt, blind heads. I click through silence like a metronome, down gum-gray sidewalks on the way to the post office, raise a glass to toast those blue-collar workers, sending all our shit, saying, wish you were here, but not really. Sports sandos take up so much light within my head, fireworks popping through the late morning mist of petrichor promise, and man, do I really hate wanting more. But I'm here to fill this flat world with hills, no, mountains, the color of my t-shirt dresses and the flavor of my skin that I ain't letting no one call burnt. I may be Japapino, but there's more beyond my blood that's not sweet, sass and sweat. I'll tell you, I love you when I finish my Disney movie marathon tomorrow night. Don't let no one tell you you can't dance without drums or the moon. Thank you.
Gosh, I loved jazz from the very first line. That was one of my particular favorites in our batch this year. So thanks for sharing. Our next reader is Jessica Cohn, whose poems appear in California Fire and Water, a climate crisis anthology, Rattle, and in numerous other journals and outlets. Check out jessicacohn.net, which I'll put in the chat in just a minute here. She's a longtime writer and editor, but she's happiest to be called a poet. Welcome, Jessica.
Thank you. It's an honor to be here. I'll just read. This poem is called The Birds. How strange the apparatus of wings. A friend shared surveillance of birds in migration, land, flattened beige, like postal paper on a box, the Great Lakes and Sion, airborne passerines and shorebirds etch-a-sketched in algae-colored dust, a sirrah, their small, warm bodies, upward movements, blossoming in time lapse. In dreams, a flock is an awakening, a lone bird, a hunch. Like any small bird, I left the Midwest in season, followed a brother, left the hail, heavy oars, and mosquitoes, and our sister, who stayed on. A red cardinal appeared after we buried our dad, after mom passed too. Robins were more common in yards of childhood. We used to break bread, scatter its white manna for bread breasts and mourning doves. We used to take binoculars and boxed powdered donuts, drive to the lakes to watch geese head south, charcoal wings roughing out directions of wind, places to go. Birds in migration portend something better, but the bird count is down by the billions since those days. I am so far gone here, where dark-eyed gulls circle berms of sand and cobble, the salted body of the Pacific, a void to the west. My brother is in the south now, behind loblolly pines and books. My sister, she holds on. The man she married is not himself. He wants to go home, even when home. When the screens of weary blue evening switch on, I watch for their weather as if it's mine. Their blue rains, purple sleet, their whiteouts, and now their birds. Flights ever fewer. Raven roams a brown field looking for seed. I pray in falcons.
Thank you. Thank you, Jessica. What a thoughtful poem. It's really detailed and wonderful. Next we have Samantha Swing, who is a student from Cupertino. Her works appeared is forthcoming in Passengers Journal, The Rising Phoenix Review, Unoya Review, and Cosmonauts Avenue, and others. Besides writing, she enjoys fencing, reading, playing the piano, and listening to music. Samantha, it's yours.
Hi, just wanted to say thank you so much for hosting this amazing event, and I'll just read now. Chinatown Part 2. On June 16th of 2021, a 94-year-old Asian woman was stabbed by a man while on her way to a grocery store in San Francisco. Baba, look at the sky tonight. There are more stars than I have ever seen. Don't you know that stars are the spirits of those that have unbirthed themselves? Meaning that the sky is full of souls that have reincarnated as light, as holes in the darkness. Baba, look at the city. Isn't San Francisco so gorgeous? Everywhere there are paper birds sewn into air, metal dragons perching on rooftops, weeds blooming through the asphalt and concrete in city streets, and last night, I tiptoed to the grocery store to buy some nectared carambola, afraid you would catch me if I made a sound, but instead it was death who caught an old woman, because there she was in the corner being stabbed by a man in his kitchen knife, and when he was done, her exit wound leaked like a melting sun in all its stars. Listen, Baba, The city is no longer gorgeous, so I will torch it with all the stars that have not died and watch the buildings dress themselves in flames. And after I'm done, we will dance together in the moonlight until the moon drowns in its own glow. And after everything has become ash, we will look at San Francisco again and it will be so much more gorgeous. Thank you.
Thank you, Samantha. That was very powerful. Such a good poem. All right. Vivian Underhill is a writer and poet living in Santa Cruz, California. She is also a doctorate candidate in feminist studies at the university here in Santa Cruz. Welcome, Vivian.
Thank you. Thank you, everyone. It's been such a wonderful evening and I feel honored to be here. We drove through the Navajo Reservation and the Hopi Reservation. I told you about the old peach orchards nestled in the canyons and the soldiers who destroyed them. Snow came and ice. The dog refused to pee, though you clucked and murmured to her softly. Shadowy elk bloomed up in the cold trees and then shrank away. A trail, but an old one and not clear whose, froze the air between us. It babbled for understanding through our mouths until I howled at your driving form. A brown bird took flight at the tree's edge. The bird became antlers that pulled an elk wild-eyed across the road. We slept in the car among small pines. Tiny dry snowflakes crackled on the roof. Your heat warmed my skin and I pulled away sweating. Morning shattered, still and diffuse. Your footsteps creaked away. Whispers of regret shivered the blankets, but I, still a pillar of ice. Oh, touch me. Thank you.
Thank you. That's a haunting poem. Thank you so much. Okay, we have just a few poems left tonight, which is very sad. But before that, we're going to be looking at one more artist, Scott Miller of Aptos, California. Scott is a polymath. He paints vivid watercolors, gardens, makes books, writes songs, sings, plays guitar, yes, and more. The images reproduced here come from a series of pieces that are part of a new book in progress to be finished around 2023. The Planet That Was Off by One. Of his art, Scott writes, I like to make paintings that are interesting to look at, that give the viewer's mind, sorry, I lost my thread, a new experience. Whenever in my mind experiences something new and interesting, especially in a painting, in music, or in a story, my mind expands a little and I can understand the world better. You can see his art and his music videos at www.waxmouth.com. I think Ken's going to put that URL in the chat.
Scott, you're here. Do you want to say anything?
No, just it's fun to be a part of this event and hear all the poetry.
You made our frontispiece, you know.
That's right, yeah.
It's like cover runner-up.
Yeah, I've always liked illustration, so I'm really happy to be in like a little book. That's where these things belong to me.
And you are making a book.
Oh yeah,
this is a series. This particular series is a
yes, yeah.
And when will that be available?
Oh, I was thinking 2023, but you know, maybe a little longer. I don't know. It's going pretty well. I'm working a lot, and
you've also shown your work in San Jose, haven't you? I know you live in Aptos, but
yeah. Yeah, I actually live in San Jose. I grew up in Aptos.
Oh, you live in San Jose now?
What?
You live in San Jose now? Oh.
Oh, yeah, long time.
Oh,
yeah.
Okay.
So I used to have a gallery in Los Angeles decades ago, but that was another life.
Yeah. Well, anyway, thanks for taking part.
Well, thank you.
Those were amazing. Very cool. Okay, well, I hate to be saying this, but we are going to be wrapping up the evening soon with some local luminaries. Lisa Ellen Ortiz's manuscript STEM is the recent winner of the 2021 Idaho Prize. She is co-translator of The Blinding Star, Selected Poems of Blanca Varela, released in 2021 from Tolson Books, and her book Guide to the Exhibit won the 2016 Perugia Press Prize. Lisa lives in Santa Cruz and loves wandering around in the forest. Hi, Lisa. Is she here? Do we have Lisa?
I don't think so.
Oh.
Yeah.
Then. Okay, then you're up, Julian, I think.
Okay. Okay, so our next reader then will be Charles Atkinson, who has authored 3 full-length poetry collections published by Hummingbird Press and 4 national prize-winning chapbooks, in addition to winning awards for individual poems. He taught writing at UC Santa Cruz for over 30 years and continues to live and write near Santa Cruz, California, with his wife, Sarah Rabkin. Welcome, Charles.
Thank you. Thank you. And thanks for all the background work you've done to make these magazines come out. It's beautiful to see the artwork in it. And let's bring this baby home, huh? The poem I'm going to read is called Like Thistledown. May flies shiver the surface, a gray early light, a mist on Crystal Lake. The old man's here, he must know where, far shore. Slide a nightcrawler onto the hook. What's a fit benediction for live bait? A quick cast, a short prayer? He's not after the paltry perch or the bluegill at this hour. Could be stalking the rumor of a full-grown largemouth bass. A fish that size can drift in an eddy, then strike from beneath and rocket into air to slip the hook it swallowed whole. Ancient creature, apex species, will eat its own, a third its size. Stop. The old man's pole bends double. He plays out slack, reels it back further each run till something heavy flops at his feet, still fighting the hook. He knows to let it be, then let it go. A day that clings like thistledown. Thank you.
Thank you, Charles. That was wonderful. Well, before we let this fish go, our final reader for this evening, truly last but not least, Rosie King grew up in Michigan. She went east for college and came to California in the 60s for graduate work. She's grateful for poems still arriving in the house by the beach where she first landed in Santa Cruz and for the poets in her writing group of many years. Her first 2 books, Sweetwater, Saltwater, and Time and Peonies, were published by Hummingbird Press. Welcome, Rosie.
Thank you. This has been a beautiful evening, and I'm enjoying going last, following Chuck, following Thistledown with quiet snow at the window. Quiet snow at the window. Through a creaked door, step down into the cool of the root cellar. Wooden crates, fragrance of Macintosh, tart, northern spy for pies. But hooray, all winter long, more delicious, red, and when out of red, golden for after school. A lapful in the big leather chair in the study. Near their seed centers, each translucent bright green star, a sweetness you could count on, like the chair's soft leather. the book. Thank you, everyone.
And thank you, Rosie. And speaking of books in winter, remember to do the following. Download Red Wheelbarrow and purchase the physical copy of Red Wheelbarrow. You should see instructions in the chat. It's a gorgeous book to hold in your hands. And it's always my favorite part of the process when it's all done. It's kind of the victory lap. Print copies should be available January of next year. That's 2022. Contributors will receive one copy free. Additional copies are $20 per book, which includes shipping and handling. Send checks pay to order of Red Wheelbarrow to information will be, I'm sure, in the chat. Also send an email confirming your order and shipping address to Ken Weisner's email, which again, I'm sure will be in the chat. For extra copies are $16, including shipping and handling. Keep writing those wonderful poems, stories, and making art and submitting them to us. It's a pleasure to read. And as Cindy mentioned earlier, there's something else about being here. When the poems are being read, we get them sort of frozen and naked. And we get them no context, no voice, or at least the poet's natural voice when they're speaking. And it's something else entirely to hear them read. So thank you for being such a wonderful audience. We will unmute now and turn off our recording. Ladies and gentlemen, you are free at this time to unfasten your seatbelts and move freely about your cabin. Good night, everybody. And thank you for creating this event.